very warm welcome on this rather cold morning. It's really nice that you made it here to the Graner Straße. It's rather far away from the other sides, but we hope it's worth the way. And I would like to welcome and introduce our three speakers tonight, Sigrid Weigel, Tomáš Sedláček and Christina von Braun. All of them well known, so I don't have to say really much, but still I will do it, of course. So let me start from Christina von Braun, the author of the book Der Preis des Geldes, eine Kulturgeschichte, The Price of Money, a Cultural History, from 2011, which is already considered basic literature, Grundlagenliteratur, as we say in German, on this topic. So it's obvious why she is here. And Christina von Braun is even more well-known maybe for her work in gender studies. She initiated and was the director of the program Gender Studies at Humboldt University in Berlin from 1996, and from 2005, head of the research training group Geschlecht als Wissenskategorie. Her book, Nicht Ich, Logik, Lüge, Libido, Not Me, Logic, Lie, Libido, published in 1985, has been reprinted 8 times today, so that speaks for itself. And just to mention, connected to her interest in the study of religion, Christina von Braun is one of the initiators and was director of the Center of Jewish Studies, Berlin-Brandenburg. There would be much more to say, of course, about you, your work, and not only your books, but also your films, but we don't have that much time, so let me move on to Tomáš Sedláček, who is the chief macroeconomic strategist at Czech Bank, a member of the Group Narrative of Europe, council member of the World Economic Forum, and a number of other important functions. And thus he's, so to speak, a practicing economist, and at the same time a theorist or a philosopher of economics, which is quite special, I would say. But then I have to add that very early in his career, 2001, Tomáš Sedláček was the economic advisor of Václav Havel, who, as you know, was not only the president of the Czech Republic, but also a playwright and a thinker, and later supported Tomáš Sedláček's book not only with a foreword. This book has attracted a lot of attention, not only in the Czech Republic. It was published in a revised and extended version in English by Oxford University Press in 2011 and in German in 2012. However, today we might also come to speak about Tomáš Sedláček's last book, written together with Oliver Tanzer, Lilith und die Dämonen des Kapitals, die Ökonomie auf Freud's Couch. Lilith and the Demons of Capital Economy and Freud's Couch, but I don't have to translate it as I see. And Sigrid Weigel has been until last year the director of the Zentrum für Literatur und Kulturforschung in Berlin and at the same time professor at the Institute for Philosophy and the History of Literature, Science and Technology at the Technical University in Berlin. And a guest professor at Princeton, Harvard, Stanford and other universities. Sigrid Weigel has initiated and contributed to a large number of projects situated in between disciplines and moreover, what's even more important, I would say, between the humanities and the sciences or the natural sciences on one hand and science and art on the other hand. Sigrid Weigel reflected also these transgressions in her project on genealogy between nature and culture, and genealogy comes up again in her latest book, the most recent book project, you have not yet finished it, as I understand, connected with money and debt. So the title will be Geld und Genealogie. Just briefly, I would like to mention the second intersection between science and art, as in the volume Wissenskünste, the knowledge of the arts and the art of knowledge, edited together with Sabine Flach, and Sigrid Weigel's work on the image condensed in the book Grammatologie der Bilder from last year. So now I would ask you to give short statements, short presentations that give us some insight into your work on the topic of God and money, which we will discuss. And we will do it in the order how you sit. So Christina von Braun will be the first one. Very warm welcome.
Hello to everybody. Thank you for your very nice introduction, Katerina Kratilova. I'm going to give a talk where I show you some images which explain a bit more. I hope I'll keep to my time. The German term Schuld corresponds both to sin and guilt and to economic debt. The Latin language allows to differentiate between guilt and debt, and yet the Italian Our Father, the prayer, does not speak of sinners but of debtors. So does the English version of the prayer according to the Bible of James I, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. The first church banks created by the Franciscans used the image of Christ on their promissory notes or debt certificates. And as you know, the Roman Catholic Church made a good fortune by issuing indulgence letters against payment. All these ideas are borne along by the fantasy that it is possible to buy one's way out of guilt in an economic way. How this close link between economy, theology, and guilt in the religious and the psychological sense came about is only comprehensible if you take a closer look at the history of money. When we refer to money as a means of exchange, these are tokens, or payment, a standard or repository of value, we are referring only to the functions of money, not to what it actually is. Money could best be described as a writing or information system. Counting tokens, for instance, the number of sheep in a flock, represented an early form of bookkeeping. Today, this is a later form of bookkeeping, if you like, it's a kind of fonds, a bond of different tokens. Today, theorists of the history of writing consider that writing developed out of the necessity of bookkeeping in larger agricultural spaces. The close relationship, this is again an account from Assyria, the close relationship between money and writing explains why the two systems continued to develop parallel to one another. The first coins were minted 150 years after the introduction of the alphabet in Greece. When the printing press was invented, paper money soon followed. Today, as we communicate with one another by email, money also circulates as an electronic impulse. It is a fact, both historically and today, that the regions with the most intensive written communication coincide with the most intense circulation of money. In this process, money became increasingly a pure sign system, and that made one point ever more pressing, the question of its certification. There are three methods to certify money. One is the authorization by a sovereign. A coin is, this is of course Pallas Athene, a coin is minted as the symbol of a city, a ruler, or a deity. They certified money. Alexander the Great was the first ruler to replace the portrait of the deity with his own. The Roman emperors followed this example, but from the very beginning, sovereigns abused this power to make a profit. A problem that all monetary theories of the past 800 years have tried to tackle without success. The second certification of money is of material kinds, such as grain or cattle. The word shekel comes from the Akkadian and means to weigh. The Latin word for money, pecunia, is derived from pecus, cattle. Our term, capital, also refers to the head in a herd of cattle whose offspring are the interest. Land was long considered a safe form to certify money due to its seeming imperishability, but the first paper money tried to use land as a means of certification. Here you can see in Virginia they used tobacco as a sign for land. But soon there was too little land to satisfy the need, and so money made itself independent of this kind of certification. Among the material goods, precious metals prove to be of utmost longevity. Paradoxically, this is so because their value is mainly symbolic. One can weigh gold or silver or test its fineness, but the actual value is and always was fictitious. In ancient Babylon, it was determined according to the religious aspects of astronomy. Throughout antiquity and well into the Middle Ages, the exchange rate of gold and silver remained at 1 to 13 1/3. Why this weird relationship? Gold symbolized the sun, silver the moon, and their relative value was, quote, derived from the relationship of the orbital rotations of these heavenly bodies to one another. Interestingly, this ratio corresponds to the ratio of capital resources and volume of credit defined by Basel I. Basel II laid down an exchange ratio of 1 to 40. This was the beginning of deregulation. This is just one of many examples of how much theology you find in finance. In short, the material certification of money also leaves much to be desired, and this is why we have a third form of certification created mainly by the Greeks of antiquity and closely linked both to religion and the idea of guilt and debt. This form of certification derives from temple sacrifice. The German word Geld, written with a T, means offering to the gods. Geld, or money, is, quote, a tribute to be paid to the divinity, end of quote. Now, what is the link between money and sacrifice? The Greek word obolos, from which our term obolus derives, the donations rendered in church, refers to pikes that were used for the sacrificial meals in the temple. Parts of these pikes became currency. They had no material but purely symbolic value derived from their function in a sacrificial ceremony. As Hellenism developed, sacrifices disappeared, but the symbol remained as a substitute for the actual sacrifice. The skewers, in turn, were replaced by coins bearing symbols of the sacrificial animals. The first Greek coin was called obolos. In short, the actual sacrifice was supplanted by a sign of the sacrifice, and it was sacrifice that certified money. The sacrificial cults took place in the temples of fertility goddesses like Artemis or Hera. The sacrifice offered to the deity was intended to move her to bless the fields, livestock, and human fertility. Until today, we find both references, both sacrifice and fertility, in money. The bull of the stock market is a remainder of the idea of sacrifice inherent to money. The bull was the most precious sacrificial animal in antiquity. Also, our modern money signs remind us of this origin. According to Alfred Kallier, the two lines in the signs for the dollar, the British pound, and more recently the euro, are relics of the bull's horns. And even bitcoins, an even more abstract form of money, have taken up the same symbolic form. Modern money also picked up the idea of fertility, as you will all remember the Groschen. And the idea of money, this is the Wirtschaftsseite of the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, the idea of money being fertile like nature permeates both our currencies and the economic pages. The language of modern finance is full of metaphors for growth, cycles, productivity, etc. And the Deutsche Bank depicts the investment advisors as female gardeners, quote, who tend to the delicate plants in your portfolios. Of the three forms of certification of money, the theological one appeared to be the most secure or the least easy to refute. And that is why until this day, even the architecture of banks and stock exchanges alludes to the Greek temple. It is this sacral appearance that allowed the banks to dispense with the convertibility of their banknotes, the Bank of England being the first to do so. Now, you have a Greek temple in every village of the world. The more precarious the material backing, the more insistent the appeal to a theological certification of money. On the American dollar bills, as you know, is written, "In God we trust and not in gold we trust." How can sacrifice, this is a commercial, how can sacrifice certify money? With this question, we move more closely to the link between guilt and debt. Sacrifice is a form of gift exchange between man and the gods. It's a bargain, thus inherent to the idea of economy. However, a sacrifice has value only when it contains the giver. Sacrifice is a matter, quote, of yielding as a pledge something of one's own, something assimilated to the body or goods of the sacrificer or the group offering the sacrifice, end of quote. In other words, when an animal was sacrificed in the temple, it actually represented and substituted a human being. It is only from this connection that money is not merely a substitute for animal sacrifice, but itself ultimately rests on a symbolic human sacrifice that one can understand why we continue to lend such credence to the pure sign. The ultimate authority that lends money its credibility is human life, the offerer contained in the sacrifice. To understand this, you have to go back to the beginning of sacrificial rites. The first societies to celebrate sacrificial cults were the first societies that engaged in agriculture and animal husbandry. Unlike hunters and gatherers, they intervened in nature and thus incurred a debt towards creation or the gods. In order to atone, sacrifices were made. The first harvest or the firstborn lamb from the herd. This is where the association between guilt towards nature or creation and debt arose, and where the close association between theology and economy began. The biblical legend of the sacrifice of Isaac being replaced by a ram reminds us of the true involvement of the human being. That money relies for its backing on the logic of human sacrifice and fertility has also become tangible in two sacrificial contexts, one referring to the female, the other to the male body. Shells, which were used in payment of bride price and are in use for exchange in general until today, this is a bank, were certified by such an idea of sacrifice. On one side, they represented the gift exchange. This money, I'm quoting, this money and those goods constitute the pledge that another bride will at some point be returned to the giver group. On the other, they represented a symbolic human sacrifice, and this sacrifice in turn certified this form of money. Why the cowrie shell? Because cowrie shells strikingly resemble the female genitalia. What did the sacrifice consist on? The domestication of female sexuality. Like nature, female fertility became subjected to societal regulation. Relics of the sacrifice can be found in female genital cutting, Chinese foot binding, and more generally, the institution of marriage, in which women were denied autonomous status concerning their sexuality. Sacrifice, referring to male sexuality, is also linked to sacrifice and fertility. The most important sacrificial animal, the bull, stood for masculinity and was offered up in rituals of sacrifice to fertility goddesses such as Artemis. Scholars have long wondered what the protrusions on the breast of Artemis responded to. They were believed to be breasts, eggs, fruits, and the like. They are fertility symbols, but not female ones. Instead, they are the testicles of the bulls sacrificed to Artemis. This was both an act of sacrifice and a fertility ritual. You find a relic of this sacrifice in circumcision. This offering implied the domestication of male sexuality. The original English word for castration is to geld and is related to the German word for money as well as to the guild as a sacrificial community. Symbolically, male castration in the sense of domesticated sexuality was a prerequisite for the fertility of money. The meaning of this symbolic castration is reflected in the history of the alphabet, a further indicator of the close ties between writing and money. All the letters of the alphabet were originally hieroglyphs, sacred symbols. The word alpha, the first and most important letter of the alphabet, is derived from the Semitic word aleph, bull or ox. The figure of the alpha went through many phases, beginning with a clearly recognizable bull's head. In the course of history, the symbol was turned on its side, assimilating the meaning of the plow. A horizontal line appeared that referred to the yoke, thus to agriculture, and to the castrated bull, the ox. Finally, the symbol took on anthropomorphic form the two lines of the A, which originally marked the bull's horns, now pointed downward and represented the legs of a man standing upright. Writing became a culture of empowerment, but it also meant symbolic castration. The bull became brainy and the pen replaced the male genitals. I saw a nice example of this in the Paris Metro, échanger à neuf, that means change everything to something new. And as it's written over his genitals, you think, well, he's going to sort of get some kind of a lifting there, but what does he get? He gets a new computer. So a nice symbol for this. This cultural turn is visible until today in Spanish bullfights. The bull enters the ring as a figure representing masculine, sexual, and physical power. The torero appears almost fragile in contrast, which is underlined by his feminine clothing. He symbolizes the power of the mind, which is supposed to win out over physical, sexual power. The power of the mind is also represented in the form of money, a money bag similar to the male genitals. This is from Greece on vases. Thus, already in ancient Greece, semen, sperm, was conflated with sima, the sign. The male seed was formed into money. A new and specific form of fertility ensued. The minted coins of Greece would be the first to produce an economic form of offspring, namely interest. This is the Gesamtvorstand of the Deutsche Bank, the management board of the Deutsche Bank. It looks a bit like the Vatican, don't you think? And the background I've just described explains why, until today, the finance sector is so hesitant to include women. Its very basis is the fertility of signs. No female body is needed. It's even an obstacle. The rules of this sector do not require renunciation of sex. They only require its regulation through money. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a very wonderful, very condensed presentation, and I'm happy I'm coming after it because half of my points have been already made. So I can now focus on the things that I would just like to add. Not only is there a very clear evidence between debt, schuld, and guilt, but as you know, the opposite of debt is credit. And there, of course, a little excursion into Latin, credit means faith. So That's the opposite side of money. One of the first thinkers that started comparing the old time priests with modern economists was Walter Benjamin, followed by John Maynard Keynes, who also in his wonderful late speech, The Great, The Economic Possibilities for Our Grandchildren, compares economists to priests who are sort of showing the way forward. Economists are the ones who these days are actually steering the course of history. It is the markets whose transcendental will is interpreted exactly by economists. It is these people who have access to the divine Olymp, which in a way shows us value, shows us the way forward, and also is extremely confusing. If you listen very carefully to the speeches of the analysts on CNN or on radio, you will hear about the whims of the market and the sentiments of the market and the moods of the market moving up and down in a completely unpredictable manner. Yet the only people who get to interpret this divine will, which is unobvious, are exactly the economists. Now, there is the beautiful thing, and I'm basically only demonstrating what you have said. The wonderful thing about money is if we say it's 1,000, it's 1,000. If we say it's 10, it's 10. If we say it's 5,000, it's 5,000. It's the same piece of paper, but the value there is exactly, this is a nice example, how the value of the paper is exactly on the symbolic level. Now that I have the banknote, not only does it have In God We Trust in the American dollar, but you will see that the most holy symbols of the nation are present on a banknote, be it great figures of the history, be it symbols of the nation, be it the signature of the central banker, etc., etc. Now, I had a speech in the European Central Bank in Frankfurt about 3 years ago, when they exactly in the week when they became the creditors of last resort. So I've named my speech "Believers of Last Resort," of course, making a very simple translation from Latin. And I was congratulating my colleagues that now you have officially become the believers of last resort, meaning, of course, when nobody trusts the economy spontaneously, these high priests have to trust the economy instead, sacrificially placing their trust exactly in the moment where nobody else would trust naturally. So when nobody believes in the future of the economy, in other words, a lack of belief in economics is represented by high interest rate. Of course, interest rate is a negative proxy to trust. The more you trust a person, the lower interest you give him or her. With family members, we typically don't charge interest, and the less I trust a given party, the higher interest I charge him or her. So the situation of today, of long-standing zero interest rates, could be also very easily interpreted as exactly these believers of last resort. If we would leave interest rates in their natural development as part of negotiation between banks, let's say, today's interest rates would be extremely high. So the natural tendency of the economy is not to trust each other. And this is where the believer of last resort enters and artificially fights against the lack of belief by its conspicuous, ostentative, exaggerated belief represented in zero interest rates. Also, another way how to read the zero interest rate is exactly in the moment where future is extremely uncertain from purely economic point of view, the national banks, not only European, but all of them, including Fed and others, are pretending as if future was risk-free. This is one way how to read the zero interest rate. In the interest rate, one can also quite nicely see something that economists are usually ashamed of, but interest rate is a beautiful example of engineering in economics. You know that interest rates have very little to do with the markets. On the contrary, it is the interest rates that constitute the very markets, and these interest rates are created or invented by these bureaucrats. Let me go a little bit into the New Testament, maybe talk about how religion or God is intertwined with economics. Of course, there is a very common notion that says that the economy wouldn't make sense without the Christian normative meaning. We have three great figures who contributed to this thought, most commonly Max Weber, whose thesis is, of course, very well known. He postulates that it was the Protestant Calvinic ethics or normativity, we would say perhaps today, that has helped give birth to modern capitalism. But he wasn't the only one. You have the slightly controversial Zombart, who believed that it was the Jewish normativity, Hebrew thought, that gave birth to capitalism. And the third thinker, most modern of them, Michael Novak, who happens to believe that it was the Catholic capitalism and the spirit and Catholic ethics. So he argues that no, it was really the Catholic ethic that gave capitalism its rise. Now, whatever interpretation you will choose to prefer, of course, the thing that will strike you immediately is that all of these three would agree that it was a religious basis of capitalism as we see it today. So the notion that economy needs the soft part of religion, in our case Christianity, is something that is quite commonly held, and one doesn't really need to go into it, and I think I will not surprise you. You've heard this number of times, but I'll try to also maybe show or put a question mark, is whether Christianity would be possible without economic parallels and without the language of economics. The whole idea of Christianity is basically that somebody else pays for our debt, for our sin, as was wonderfully pointed here in the New Testament Greek. Ophelon is the same word, just like in German, for Schuld. Also works in Aramaic, and also works in many ancient and modern languages. Two-thirds of Jesus' parables are of economic nature, if you think of it. The whole idea of Christianity, redemption, is an economic act. In Slavic languages, such as Czech, vykoupení, salvation, you even hear the word purchase. Vykoupit in Slavic languages is to purchase out. So salvation in Slavic languages is to be bought at a price. Of course, a more interesting theological question is, to whom did God pay the price for us, for sin? If this seems a little bit abstract, and it may, we can fast forward 2,000 years to today, and we can read Financial Times or any Handelsblatt or any economic newspaper. It's great fun. One of my basic tricks is to read religious texts economically and economic texts religiously. So when you open the Financial Times, you will, it's a pity I didn't bring a picture, government redeems banks. Government buys out, bails out, saves banks. And the process there is exactly same like in Christianity, because the principle there is the same, that an entity with low credit, low faith, low trust, low future prospects, such as, for example, Greece today, or certain banks, their sin, their debt, is transferred on the shoulder of somebody else, government in this case, somebody who has higher credit, somebody who has higher faith, both in terms of the future and in terms of the market believing in German government much more than the market believes in Greece government. This is why Germany, to follow the newspaper cliche, could take upon itself the sins or the debts of Greece. So only knowing two small little Latin words, credo, meaning faith or trust, and debt, meaning guilt or perhaps even sin, reading Financial Times becomes extremely entertaining because the articles resemble New Testament texts almost to the point. So let me just do a small little paraphrase of what you were all reading a couple of years back, even till today. So the Greeks, it's interesting that it's also happening exactly with Greeks today. The Greeks are falling under the weight of their sin, debt. They can no longer carry it. There is no way that they can atone, pay back their sins. This is also a secret that everybody knows. It is impossible for Greece to save itself. Similar moment you will hear resonating in Christianity. Somebody has to come and redeem, take their sins upon its shoulder, hoping that its faith, credit will be strong enough to carry the sin of somebody else. By carrying the first step is to take the sin from the sinner, take the debt from the debtor, put it on somebody else's shoulder, and either carry them on or pay. This is also, of course, the first public speech you will remember from your Sunday schools that Jesus has. He reads in the synagogue, he reads a scroll from the prophet Isaiah. I have come to proclaim the year of Jubilee, the year of mercy, the year of forgiveness. I have come to set the debt captives or sinners free. Because what happened in these societies is you could become a slave either by being captive in the process of a war, or when you fell into debt captivity or debt servitude, when you couldn't pay back your loans. Now, taking loans in these agricultural societies, I'm talking of Palestine or Israel 2,000 years back, when they already became agrarian, one has to understand that you harvested your crops, but you must not eat everything you harvested. You had to save a little part of the food to use as seeds next year. So just imagine that perhaps there was a bad year and you are really, the whole family is running extremely hungry, perhaps even your children dying, while you are having sacks of corn in your basement, but you knew you must not touch this corn because otherwise the whole family would perish. It also created an extreme problem in planning because you didn't know how long the winter will last. Maybe tomorrow you don't need it anymore. Maybe you need the crops for two more months. It was an extremely complicated situation. So the poor peasants would enter debt in terms of borrowing crop from the rich landowners. And this was also one way how free people became servants and how land was sort of monopolized by the owners of the capital, which is beautifully described in David Graeber's book, Debt, the history of the first 5,000 years. I think I'm running slowly out of time, so I will round up. My basic point here is that not only economics has an extremely religious component to it, as was beautifully shown, but also the other way around, religion, in our case, Christianity has an extremely strong economic logic and economic argumentation to it, and one cannot really stand without each other. Thank you very much.
Ich glaube, die Reihenfolge hat sich jetzt als ganz günstig erwiesen, weil ich mich vor allen Dingen auf die Frage konzentrieren will, wie wir eigentlich umgehen mit der Beobachtung, die ja von beiden Rednern geteilt wurde, dass in der gegenwärtigen ökonomischen Rhetorik viele religiöse Metaphern da sind. Das hat Thomas vor allen Dingen gezeigt, und Christina von Braun hat gezeigt, wie Symbole aus der Herkunft des Geldes, aus dem Opfer, in der heutigen Rede über und vor allen Dingen Darstellung in den Bildern nachleben. Die Frage ist eigentlich, was sagt uns das, wenn heute in der Ökonomie religiöse Metaphern vorkommen? Und ich denke, eine zu einfache Deutung wäre die, dass das Geld heute eine Art Ersatzreligion ist. Insofern unterscheiden sich die beiden Vorträge in meiner Sicht dann doch sehr stark, weil wir einerseits gehört haben etwas Kulturgeschichtliches über die Herkunft des Geldes aus dem Opfer und andererseits eine vielfach heute zu hörende These, nämlich dass die Börse sowas wie eine Ersatzreligion heute ist. Diese Metapher Gott, Geld, das Geld ist der neue Gott, sozusagen, ist eine Metapher, die zusammenhängt oder entstanden ist in der bürgerlichen Gesellschaft, sowohl affirmativ als auch kritisch. Da treffen sich in merkwürdiger Weise Analysen von Karl Marx, der in seinem Aufsatz zu Mills Elements of Political Economy schreibt, dass das Geld zum wirklichen Gott geworden sei und das auch versucht, dann genauer zu begründen, indem er das Geld als Mittler mit der Mittlerfunktion von Christus vergleicht. Wobei Gott und Christus verwechselt, aber das ist vielleicht nebensächlich. Ähnlich hören wir von Theologen immer wieder die Aufforderung, wir müssten uns entscheiden, ob wir Gott vertrauen wollen oder dem Geld vertrauen wollen. Das sind sozusagen zwei Seiten derselben Argumentation. Was sind die Voraussetzungen dieser Argumentation? Sie sind selbstverständlich christlich, und zwar in dem Dogma des Gottvertrauens, das an die Stelle einer selbsttätigen Sorge oder Vorsorge gestellt wird. Das biblische Zeugnis dafür ist Matthäus 6, 24. Niemand kann zwei Herren dienen, ihr könnt nicht Gott dienen und dem Mammon. Darum sorgt nicht für morgen, denn der morgige Tag wird das Seine sorgen. Also wir brauchen keine Vorsorge, das macht sozusagen die Vorsehung für uns. Was daraus entstanden ist, ist eine extreme Ambivalenz im Christentum gegenüber dem Geld. Wir haben dazu interessante Beispiele gehört. Ich will nun mal auf eine Szene eingehen. Im Mittelalter und ausgehenden Mittelalter, am Übergang zur Neuzeit, war diese Ambivalenz besonders stark, weil einerseits mit dem Wucherzins, das hat Christina sehr schön schon alles entwickelt, und der Drohung der Höllenqual, das Geld eben ein Entsühnungsversprechen bedeutete, auf der anderen Seite eben die Kirche im hohen Maß in die Geldpolitik, und zwar in den Austausch des Geldes mit den profanen Regierenden eingebunden war. Man kann diese Ambivalenz sehr schön studieren an den Fresken von Masaccio in der Brancacci-Kapelle in Florenz. Also einerseits mit der Darstellung des Zinsgroschen, Jesus aufgefordert vom Zöllner Simon Zinsen zu zahlen, bringt ihm erstmal bei, dass die Zinsen eigentlich nur von Fremden genommen werden, sagt dann aber, wir wollen keinen Ärger, und fordert Petrus auf, aus dem Fischmaul das Goldstück zu holen und dem Zöllner das Gold zu geben. Das wird in diesem Bild dargestellt, sozusagen einerseits als Widerstand gegen die Forderung weltlicher Zinsforderung und andererseits aber dann auch als Nachgeben um des Liebensfriedenswillens. Also diese Ambivalenz geht sozusagen durch die Geschichte des Christentums und verfolgt uns eigentlich bis heute. Die Rhetorik aber, Gott, das Geld als Gott zu verstehen, verkennt sehr häufig die Herkunft des Geldes aus dem Opfer, und zwar in der Beziehung, dass diese Herkunft aus dem Opfer eben eine Problematik des Vergleiches, also der Äquivalenz von Anökonomischen mit Ökonomischen. Also Anökonomisches sei es der Leib, das hat Christina mit den Fruchtbarkeitssymbolen gezeigt, sei es sozusagen das Leben, wird in Messbares konvertiert. Deswegen interessiere ich mich für die Operation der Konvertierung. Zur kulturgeschichtlichen Herleitung des Geldes aus dem Opfer gibt es verschiedene Gründungserzählungen. Die eine ist die Gründungserzählung aus der Antike, dem Stieropfer, dem Tieropfer, das ersetzt wird dann, also das Tiergeld sozusagen, durch Münzeinheiten, wobei das Opfer als eine höhere Form des Gabenverkehrs und des Verkehrs mit den Göttern betrachtet wird und Kultgesetze sehr genau regeln, welche Anteile von dem Opfer, vom Stier, den Göttern zusteht. All diese Dinge wissen wir eigentlich erst dadurch, dass sich die Kulturwissenschaft um 1900 für diesen Zusammenhang von Religion und Ökonomie und Moderne interessiert hat, unter der Fragestellung, auf welche Art und Weise Religion in der Moderne nachlebt. Und das Nachleben ist kein Fortleben, kein Kontinuum, sondern im Nachleben verwandeln sich auch die Zusammenhänge. Ich beziehe mich da vor allen Dingen auf den Klassiker, nämlich Bernhard Laums Buch über heiliges Geld von 1924 oder auch auf ein Buch von Ernst Curtius über den religiösen Charakter der griechischen Münzen von 1872. Aus diesem Forschungszusammenhang wissen wir sehr viel über diese Herkunft des Geldes aus dem Opfer. Die andere Gründungserzählung ist die, die die Ethnologen uns überliefert haben. Das hat Christina auch sehr schön schon gezeigt mit dem Muschelgeld, mit den Tokens und so weiter. Das sind sogenannte archaische Gesellschaften oder wie es in der Ethnologie immer heißt, Naturgesellschaften, die eben Formen des Geldes, des Geldes in der Funktion des Tauschmediums entwickelt haben und dabei eben eine Kultur und das eingebunden in eine Kultur der Gastfreundschaft und der Gabe. Deswegen ist die Gabe heute eben unter den Bedingungen der Flüchtlinge und der geforderten Gastfreundschaft auch wieder eine aktuelle Theorie geworden, wobei häufig eben übersehen wird, dass Marcel Mauss sehr genau herausgearbeitet hat, wie die Kultur der Gabe auch in hierarchische Strukturen und Machtstrukturen eingebunden ist, also in ganz klare Gesetzmäßigkeiten, wie Gabe zu funktionieren hat, genau wie die Kultgesetze in der Antike eben genaue Regeln vorschrieben. Diese Gründungserzählungen sind für uns insofern interessant, als man daraus auch bestimmte Erkenntnisse über das Problem dieses Zusammenhangs von Religion und Geld ermitteln kann. Und ich konzentriere mich dabei eben auf dieses Problem der Verwandlung von anökonomischen oder nicht äquivalenten in Messbares, das eben durch das Geld überhaupt, durch die Münzen überhaupt erst möglich wird. In welcher Weise hat uns das später weiterhin noch zu beschäftigen und beschäftigt uns. Es gibt Formen des symbolischen Tausches zwischen dem Anökonomischen und dem Geld, natürlich auch schon in der Vergangenheit. Und daher kommt eigentlich auch die Vorstellung vom Geld. Das hat vor allen Dingen Simmel herausgearbeitet in seiner Philosophie des Geldes, wo er die Figur des Entgeltes als Ursprung sowohl von Schuld und Schulden auch herausgearbeitet hat. Das hat Christina von Braun mit dem Brautgeld als Beispiel gezeigt. Entgelt ist eine ziemlich interessante Figur. Entgelt heißt nämlich, dass etwas, was potenziell möglich ist, wie etwa Fruchtbarkeit, ein weiblicher Körper, der eine Reproduktionsfähigkeit als Potenz sozusagen in sich hat, oder ein getöteter Mensch, durch den die Arbeitskraft verloren gegangen ist, dass diese Potenzialität sozusagen entgolten wird durch Geld, durch etwas Messbares. Das ist eine interessante Figur, weil sie bis ins Strafrecht heute hineinreicht, nämlich die Konversion von Verbrechen in Entgelt. Es gab im Mittelalter eine Kultur, die auf eine andere Weise diese Konversion von anökonomischen in ökonomisches praktiziert hat, nämlich eine sogenannte Jenseitsökonomie, in der Memoria und Totenkult gegen Erbe, Vererben von Gut und Geld getauscht wird. Das heißt, diejenigen, die etwas zu vererben haben, fordern dafür von ihren Nachkommen die Memoria. Das wurde von den Mittelalterhistorikern als Jenseitsökonomie beschrieben, was ich ein sehr schönes Wort finde, weil es zeigt, dass diese Schwelle zwischen dem Jenseits und dem Diesseits eben versucht wird, durch Geld gleichsam zu überbrücken. Eine moderne, aktuelle Form, in der diese Ungleiche, was ich eben das Ungleiche im symbolischen Tausch nenne, fortlebt, ist die Praxis der Wiedergutmachung. Also Schuld und Schulden hängen nicht einfach nur zusammen, sondern was dazwischen als Lücke zu denken ist, ist die Verwandlung von Schuld in Schulden. Das heißt, die Verwandlung von Gehandelten in Messbares und die Illusion, man könne durch das Entgelt wieder gut machen. Das hängt natürlich damit zusammen, dass wir das nicht mehr sehen, dass wir diese Problematik des Anökonomischen, das verschwindet in der Geldwirtschaft, nicht mehr sehen, wird begleitet, sagen wir mal so, durch die Ausdehnung dessen, was für Geld zu erwerben ist, die gegenwärtig rasant fortschreitet. Das hat Michael Sandler sehr schön in seinem Buch beschrieben, was man für Geld nicht kaufen kann, die moralischen Grenzen des Marktes von 2012, in dem man unendlich viele erschütternde Beispiele dafür findet, was man alles für Geld heute kaufen kann, was wir nicht für möglich gehalten hätten. Die Problematik dieser Konversion des ungleichen Tausches, des ungleichen symbolischen Tausches, ist meiner Ansicht nach in wunderbarer Weise dargestellt, zum ersten Mal in sehr verdichteter Form in Shakespeares Kaufmann von Venedig. Ich lese diesen Text als einen Text, der zeigt, wie die Zirkulation zwischen Verwandtschaft, Geld und Gesetz nach ähnlichen Gesetzen der Konversion funktioniert, die aber immer diesen Rest produzieren bei der Verwandlung von Leib in Erbschaft oder auch einen Heiratsvertrag, Kredit in Entgelt, wofür das Fleisch wiederum steht und dann das Gesetz aber dieses Ding wieder als unmöglich beschreibt, weil eben die Verleiblichung sozusagen des Kredits eine Idee wäre, etwas wieder zurückzuführen, zu restituieren, was eben durch diesen Rest des Anökonomischen nicht möglich ist. Mich interessiert also insbesondere die Verquickung von Geld und Genealogie, die auch eingebunden ist in Erbe und Erbvorgänge, transgenerationelle Vorgänge und das Problem der Reproduktion von Schulden in der Generationenfolge. Wir sind ja gegenwärtig insbesondere mit dem Problem der Staatskredite befasst. Die Staatskredite sind eine relativ moderne Erscheinung, weil sie die Geldbeschaffungspolitik der Monarchen im Ancien Regime ersetzt haben durch eine Steuer- und Schuldenpolitik des Staates. Insofern sind die Staatskredite und die heutige Form der Schulden, mit denen wir zu tun haben, gebunden an die Geburt des modernen Staates, mit dem gleichzeitig das Konzept der Generation, der Zukunft und der Staatsverschuldung ins Spiel kam. Und zwar in einer Verbindung, die genau die Probleme geschaffen hat, mit denen wir heute zu tun haben. Warum Generation? Weil zum ersten Mal um 1800 Generation sowohl als Abfolge als auch als Altersgruppe gedacht worden ist und die Französische Revolution, die sich vor allen Dingen gegen das Erbrecht des Ancien Régime gewendet hat, sich folgende Parole auf die Fahnen geschrieben hat: Keine Generation hat das Recht, das Leben der künftigen Generation zu bestimmen. Also eine Orientierung an den künftigen Generationen und an den Nachkommen, dadurch auch eine Veränderung des Erbrechts, wobei das Interessante ist, dass das zu einer Kapitalisierung des Erbrechts geführt hat, nämlich zum ersten Mal ist im Code Napoleon das Erben von den Eltern als die erste Form des Erwerbs definiert worden. Die Staatsverschuldung, weil der Staat sozusagen die Finanzpolitik in die Hände genommen hat, und dabei kam das Problem der Zeit auf neue Weise ins Spiel. Die Zeit ist in der Ökonomie immer schon eingebunden im Zins. Der Zins ist ja sozusagen ein Geld für die Potenz der Zeit, des Kapitals oder des Geldes, mit dem man hätte arbeiten können als Gläubiger, es aber dem Schuldner gibt und der stattdessen eben für diese entgangene Zeit der Arbeit mit dem Geld den Zins gibt. Mit der Staatsverschuldung und der Generation kommt aber eine genealogische Zeit ins Spiel. Insofern, als die Frage der übergenerationellen Laufzeit von Schulden plötzlich auf der Tagesordnung stand. Und hier führe ich immer wieder ein sehr kluges Modell der Finanzpolitik an, das Jefferson damals in die Diskussion gebracht hat und an das wir uns heute erinnern sollten. Und zwar hat Jefferson moderne Demografieforschung mit einer biblischen Haltung verbunden, nämlich mit der Haltung oder der Auffassung, wir sind nur Gast auf dieser Erde, uns gehört die Erde nicht. Vor uns waren Lebende, deren Erbe wir sozusagen zu verantworten haben, und nach uns werden andere Generationen kommen. Wenn wir also einen Kredit aufnehmen oder aufnehmen müssen, dann müssen wir dafür sorgen, dass dieser Kredit innerhalb der Lebenszeit dieser Generation zurückgezahlt wird. Insofern hat er mit den neuen Methoden seiner Zeit der Demografie, nämlich Rechnen von Lebenszeit, durchschnittlicher Lebenszeit, also Frühformen der Statistik, beantwortet eine moralisch-ethische Haltung gegenüber den künftigen Generationen. Also es lohnt meiner Ansicht nach sozusagen einen Blick zurück auf die Urszenen der modernen Ökonomie, um sich diese Zusammenhänge von Verschuldung in einem anderen Sinne, nämlich an den Schuldnern, an den späteren Gläubigern, das ist ja ein Zusammenhang von transgenerationellen Schuldner- und Gläubigerverhältnissen und aktuellen Schuldner- und Gläubigerverhältnissen, um sich das nochmal genauer anzusehen. Wir wurden aber im Exposé für diese Veranstaltung auch mit der Frage konfrontiert, woher kommt eigentlich das Vertrauen ins Geld? Und mir scheint es eben dann doch zu einfach zu sein, um zu sagen, das Geld ist an die Stelle Gottes getreten. Das Vertrauen ins Geld ist nämlich, wie wir sehen, generationell und erfahrungsbedingt sehr, sehr unterschiedlich. Das heißt, Generationen, die historische Erfahrungen gemacht haben von Inflation, Krieg und Ähnlichem, haben eine vollkommen andere Haltung gegenüber dem Geld. Und ich will mal drei Haltungen unterscheiden, die man beobachten kann. Nämlich eine Haltung des Vertrauens ins Geld im Hinblick auf den Wert, den Geldwert. Das ist sozusagen die Strumpfsparpolitik unserer Großmütter. Dann ein Vertrauen in die Bank als Verwalter des Geldes. das ist sozusagen die Haltung unserer Eltern, die aufgewachsen sind in der sozialen Marktwirtschaft und noch beigebracht bekommen haben. Sie können eben nicht mehr auf das Gottvertrauen, sondern sie müssen die Vorsorge selber in die Hand nehmen und sparen und über den Zins sozusagen ihre Alterszeitversorgung sichern. Das dritte wäre das Vertrauen in den Staat und die Steuerungsmittel der Finanzpolitik, wobei wir wissen, seit der EZB und der offensiven Niedrigzinspolitik der Zentralbanken, dass der Staat eigentlich keine wirklichen Mittel der Finanzsteuerung mehr in der Hand hat. Und Josef Vogel hat mit seiner These der Zentralbanken als vierter Gewalt ja genau entwickelt, wie die Souveränität über die Finanzpolitik nach dem Zweiten Weltkrieg abgegeben worden ist an die Zentralbanken. Insofern, wenn wir uns jetzt auf die Eurokrise konzentrieren, würde ich daraus die These entwickeln, dass die Einführung einer gemeinsamen Währung, die Einführung des Euro oder einer Währungseinheit, kann man beschreiben als Sündenfall der europäischen Gemeinschaft als einer politischen und kulturellen, als eines politischen und kulturellen Projektes. Weil in dem Maße, in dem die Souveränität an die EZB abgegeben worden ist, vorher an die nationalen Zentralbanken, tatsächlich politische Instrumente der Steuerung aus der Hand gegeben worden sind. Das wird jetzt auch ganz offen affirmativ formuliert. Mir fiel ins Auge ein Artikel von Norbert Röttgen im August 2015. Das war die heiße Zeit der Verhandlung über den dritten Kredit an Griechenland, in der wir von vielen deutschen Politikern immer wieder gesagt bekamen, es ist in unserem Interesse, unserem heißt die Deutschen, dass Griechenland im Euroraum bleibt, wobei natürlich dies uns oder wir eine phantasmatische Konstruktion ist, weil sie meint die deutsche Wirtschaft. Denn de facto, das wissen wir, ist seit der Einführung des Euros, sind die vor allen Dingen Niedriglöhne rapide gesunken und die Schere zwischen Arm und Reich in Deutschland enorm auseinandergegangen. Nicht nur im Einkommen, sondern auch im Vermögen. Also eine Verarmung hat in Deutschland selber auch stattgefunden. Es geht also nicht um Deutschland und Griechenland. Und das ist, glaube ich, das größte Problem im Moment, diese Nationalisierung der ganzen Schuld- und Schuldendebatte, während es tatsächlich um eine Problematik geht, in der ein Auseinanderdriften von Politik und Zentralbankpolitik stattfindet. Röttgen schreibt also in diesem Artikel, der mir wirklich die Augen geöffnet hat, der Euro ist unumkehrbar, allerdings nicht unzerstörbar. Mit der Europäischen Währungsunion ist an die Stelle der diversen nationalen Währungen und Währungspolitiken eine neue gemeinschaftliche Souveränität getreten. Mit der Europäischen Währungsunion. Sie kennt schon rechtlich keinen Austritt, geschweige denn einen Ausschluss. Also aus der Kirche kann man immerhin austreten, aus der Währungsunion nicht. Insofern ist der Vergleich schon nicht mehr triftig. Und ich denke, dass eben diese Rede von der Ersatzreligion insbesondere verkennt, das ist eigentlich meine Hauptthese, diese Reste des Anökonomischen. Und man muss nur einmal in die Länder fahren und vor Ort gehen, wo die dramatischen Folgen der Sparauflagen, der Privatisierungsauflagen und so weiter gelebt werden, um mit diesen Problemen des Anökonomischen konfrontiert zu werden. Vielen Dank.
I think that several things mentioned are really important for this, the topic of the whole conference, the whole symposium. And I would just to want to pick you stressing the non-economic, because I think that in what I've heard so far talking about exchange, it has not come up yet really, and in its meaning, because this changing something into something that can be measured first of all, and then you can exchange. It's two steps, and we've always started at the second step already, when you have everything as a commodity, everything can be exchanged. And then we have different forms of exchange. But this part of, okay, there is something else which is not economic, and it has to be transformed into something that can be dealt with and that can be transformed into a commodity. But I would like to give you the opportunity, of course, to react. I think Tomáš would maybe like to react to what Sigurd Weiger has a bit criticized or pointed out. So please go ahead. And of course, you are all invited to join the discussion.
I enjoyed it very much. A couple of thoughts came to my mind. Keynes talks about in the economic possibilities of our grandchildren. He develops extremely religious language when he talks that the basic line of that essay is that not in my lifetime, not in the lifetime of your children, but in the lifetime of your grandchildren, mankind will become so affluent, new Adam, he uses the term new Adam will be born. This is, of course, very strong religious language. Not only Old Testament, but you know that Jesus was also offered to him, referred to as the new Adam, Adam in Hebrew meaning man, new man, who becomes ethical because of his affluence, because of his wealth. This is my reading of it, anyway. Ethics becomes cheap. It will be very cheap, relatively to our wealth, for us to take care of the poor people. It will, let's say, take only 1% of our wealth. So for 1% of our wealth, we can buy ethical peace of mind, which is interesting because the structure is wealth, internal transformation of a man, similar to the salvation transformation that Jesus talks about, and then follows the ethics. In Hebrew thought, especially in Hebrew thought, it was the other way around. It was ethics. Through ethics, you become a new man. And then, as a blessing from divinity, you become rich and affluent. So this, I think, is something that should be mentioned here also. The subject, what we know in philosophy as a subject-object reversal, is taking place. This, I think, is one of the fundamental areas where economy, in a way, does take place of the transformation potential of religion. You see this in many movies. You also see this in many beliefs. It is one of the fundamental beliefs of European Union that we will stick together basically with the glue of economics. Not with art, not with religion, not with food exchange, and you know, we cook Indian food for you and Europeans will cook European food for Indians, but that the basic glue of the most troubled continent in the history of mankind, namely Europe, will be glued together with the most coercive glue, which is the glue of economics. This, whether this holds or not, I leave it to your discretion, but it definitely was the main idea of the founding fathers of the European Union. If you want to make it little, because it's Friday, so it's in a way a twist of the hippie slogan, make love, not war. The slogan of European Union is in a way, make trade, not work, not war. and it worked. For better or for worse, it worked. So we can even ask ourselves a troubling question, whether, and you know, I'm a big critique of economy, big fan of European Union, interestingly. But has religion Even though religion postulates it in one of the main promises, Christianity and all other religions, they talk about peace, they talk about love, they talk about brothers and sisters not quarreling with each other. In the history of Christianity, this really never took place. We've been always fighting with each other for reasons of how to baptize or whether we can sell indulgences. So, is the economy a better societal glue than religion is a big question that I think, I'm very young, so my opinion is not yet formed here. But as of today, I would perhaps even say that economy, in my view, interestingly, has become a stronger societal glue than religion ever in its history, and that perhaps even stronger glue than culture, or rather art. Of course, very difficult to separate the two, but that's my reaction, if I may, to the questions that you posed. Question number two, Marx very famously and atheistically said that religion is the opium for the masses. And yesterday in Potsdam, we had a great debate about this, normativity and positivity in economic social science. I rather call economics social science fiction, because economics is often very not scientific and definitely not social. But my question there was, wasn't it really Marx and the positivist science that introduced opium for the masses truly? So you can even say that modern social science is more normative in its messianic promises to mankind that we will bring peace to peace on earth through the means of economic exchange and cooperation, that we will solve the problem of hunger, that we will solve the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, that we will solve the immigration conflict, that we will solve the Ukrainian crisis, that we will solve the Ukrainian conflict by the usage of money. This is how European Union has been solving all its problems as of recently. It always, no matter what the problem was, Syrian war, Ukrainian war, we have been solving it with economic means only. So perhaps it is social science that is offering mankind a much more normative opium for the masses rather than religion, which sort of takes human being as is, whereas a social science innovatively and in disguise wants to change society to a better one. So this is my two thoughts that I would like to offer.
Well, thank you very much for both your talks. First to Thomas, I agree with you. It's no coincidence that capitalism and the free market economy developed within the Christian cultural field. This is quite closely linked to Christianity. But the main point about Christian theology is one point which is rarely mentioned, the idea of guilt. In Christianity, you have God offering himself for humanity. This is an idea which you find in no other theological concept. It's always man that offers to the God so that God gives something back. But in this case, it's God that offers himself to humanity. And this is a gift which you cannot respond to. It's too big. You can in no way equalize this gift. So this creates an eternal dependence of man on God, and there are three ways of solving the problem. One is to accept this dependence, and thus to remain in this dependence by believing, by being a deep believer. The second possibility is, of course, to say, no, it's somebody else who brought the sacrifice about, namely the Jews, who brought about the sacrifice of Jesus. So it's the Jews, that are wrong, and that's why we have all these economic explanations for the pogroms of Christian history. And then the, which is of course a way of going into a new guilt every time you create a new guilt. And then the third possibility is to at last produce enough money to pay back God. So you can really try to understand this enormous productivity of capitalism, how we accumulate and multiply money and money. We want at last to pay out God enough cash to get him out of the business and our back, our independence. I think this is a very, very important point about Christian theology, which explains why it's become so important in this cultural field. Now, to Sigrid, I liked your talk very much. There's at the very end, there was one point which came to me. Somehow the United States had the same problem when the United States were created. They had to accept a common currency. There were very different states, North Carolina, Virginia, New Jersey, whatever. It was a big fight to accept one currency and to have a new sovereign. Why did the United States solve the problem, and why shouldn't Europe solve the problem too? That is my question to you, because I think I'm not quite as pessimistic as you are. I think you're right. The euro has been really a problem for this gap, income gap between the richer and the poorer in Europe. But the problem has already been solved within modern economy by the United States. So maybe this could be an example that makes you a bit more optimistic.
So, first, I never deal with optimism and pessimism because that's not the question. I think it's a question of historical and cultural analysis. And the case of the United States is different because it's an immigration society. So it has been developed in modernity and from migrants. Okay, we don't now talk on the relationship to the Indians and so on. But in the case of Europe, we have very different cultural, let's say, economic cultures as traditions. Mm-hmm. So the relationship between traditional tribal forms of economy in relation to the market and the exchange system and system of taxes and credits and so on is very different. Mm-hmm. And what took place with the invention of the euro was that a German, Western European, but mainly German principle of economy was superimposed on the other cultures. And now we see that there is tension, but also interplay between these old tribal forms of economic culture mm-hmm. and new forms of corruption. You can observe this in very different places. But the seduction of getting credit, we also know this from Africa. So the relationship of the IWF to the African states is a very sad story mm-hmm. because they offered money. When they were not able to pay it back, there was this pressure for privatization, and now all the sources
and all the structures
go out of the country. Mm-hmm. And this now takes place in Greece too. So I have to confess that I felt totally ashamed when reading that Fraport, the Frankfurt airport, bought the Greek airports. Mm-hmm. Due to the privatization, which was not voluntary, but because this,
Greece had to accept in order to...
Putin is buying Thessaloniki now, no?
Yeah, but it's not a relativation. I mean, it's not a relativation. And what also supports this kind of policy is the way how German publicity deals with topics. So there was a very interesting inquiry into the question how much the German state, Schäuble, spared due to this crisis. And it was even more than we, in case that of the Grexit, have to pay. Yeah. This was just one day in the newspaper, and then it was away. So the whole, the whole topic is not in the foreground. It's not in the newspapers, but only the question of taxes, pensions, guilt, and debts. And that's a problem. And therefore, I talk on Sündenfall of the euro, because there are very good analyses about the profit. The whole profit since the invention of the euro for whole Europe, and more than a third went to Germany. Mm-hmm. So, and it's not Germany, but it's German economy and not the people. And therefore, we should talk more about who is the agency, who's the actor, and not Germany and Greece. So this is one topic, but I want also discuss the relation between religion and economy, which is a more, let's say, critical or theoretical question. It's obvious that economic rhetoric and literature is full of religious metaphors. But what does it say? What does this mean? It's so obvious. It doesn't say anything. It only says something when we start to analyze in which way religions has an afterlife in modern economy. And I became aware about the problem of this unequal exchange of what's always at stake in forms of conversion, because unequal phenomena or things are exchanged. When I worked and studied on the German project on restitution, this was I worked since long on this topic, and the restitution, Wiedergutmachung, in German is also a psychological term. And it means that the perpetrator gets restituted in a moral sense. In this, simultaneously, when the victim receives the money. So that's the illusion of one could restitute also history. But it's not possible. And after analyzing this policy, I became aware that this is a kind of regular structure within all kinds of conversion. And then Shakespeare's Shylock became very important for me, because there the problem is depth and the body. So the body can't get converted into money, but it's a very old tradition to do that. Yes. Not the body, but the potentiality of the body, the reproductivity, the fertility, and so on. And we still are confronted with this problem. And therefore, I say, economy and money is not the new religion.
and we have to take religion much more seriously. So the sentence, the statement of Marx that religion is the opium for the people is one of his stupid sentences. And now what we at this time currently experience is the renaissance of religion in the same time as economy is so strong that there's no more political means to control it.
Yep.
So this says something, that there's a renaissance of religion in the same time when economy becomes the sovereign.
Yep.
But it doesn't say that economy is the new religion. In contrast. And therefore, I go back to the emergence of money from religion, and Christina showed us beautiful pictures for that, in order to analyze that in the very beginning there is this problem of the N or non-economic, inscribed in the birth of money. It's always there, but we can't see it. And when you refer to just paper, it's only the representation of money or data. But paper money, data money, digital money only hides more this unequal exchange. It's more invisible.
So is the religious component obvious or is it hidden?
It's on because, the paper, so
but because
it's
we started
there.
That it's obvious, and now
but it's
you
not an it's not an religious component, but it's the impact, the afterlife, of something, some problem that is inscribed in the religious origin of money in sacrifice. And that's something different.
Yeah. So let me react. Just very briefly, Greek collapse has almost nothing to do with euro. It would have happened if we had individual currencies. California went also bankrupt, even though they had the common currency. And this fear of yours, which I share, that the economy is becoming stronger than, let's say, politics, is exactly one of the reasons why I am more pro-European, because we have globalized economy. We have non-globalized politics. We can coordinate ourselves as mankind economically very quickly. I can get the juice from Kuala Lumpur in 5 minutes. Almost at no transaction cost, but it's very difficult politically to be coordinated. So this is why I am rather on the political coordination, exactly to battle out the counterpart, the economic globalized world. So this is just a point number one. Point number two, I absolutely understand what you're saying, but you could also read the Old Testament. And here I am, of course, a little bit at disadvantage for not being able to read Hebrew properly. But the price of an eye is an eye. The wage of, and this is extremely, of course, disgusting to today, but the wage of rape was a bull. It was a price for a moral misendeavor. Or if you murdered a slave by accident, you had to pay for it by bull or by your own hand. So one could even say that this is not possible today. That in this way we have de-economized ethics. One could say, because if I murder somebody, I cannot pay myself out of it properly. And this idea of original sin that we cannot pay back. As a fundamentally Christian idea, you can even find that a little bit in the debt that we are born into as members of the Western society. By being born today, you are born in debt that has been created to you by politicians. And this is a interesting. This is my interpretation of the original sin. In Christian, especially in Catholic tradition, the original sin is often interpreted in sexual connotation, especially in the Middle Ages. The whole idea of Jesus being of immaculate conception means that all other conceptions are maculate, dirty, exactly tainted by this idea that sexual reproduction has something to do with original sin, which is interesting because if you read the first three chapters of the book of, or the third chapter of the book of Genesis, you will find very little mention, or actually no mention of sex at all. There is one mention of sex in the second chapter in the positive way, go and multiply and fill the earth. But there is another word which is repeated 23 times over 1.5 chapters, and that is the word consume. You shall not consume. The snake said it's good for consumption, so she consumed. She gave Adam to consume. The word consume or eat repeats itself 22 times over one page of the Eden story of creation, which, of course, offers a thought that the original sin was, in fact, a sin of rather consumption, because sola scriptura, they consumed something that they shouldn't consume, and they consumed something that they didn't need to consume. They didn't consume it out of hunger. They consumed it out of, we don't really know why. So there's also, I think, an interesting way of reading the original sin as a sin of overconsumption. Interestingly enough, and I will also end here, there's a nice link between material possession and moral psychology. The moment Adam and Eve get dressed, again, they don't get dressed for biotic reasons. They didn't get dressed because they were cold. They got dressed for moral or psychological reasons because they felt shame. So there's a nice connection, I think, here in the very first chapters of the book of Genesis, the connection between material possession and moral feeling of inferiority.
Thanks very much. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. It's just too short time for this big topic, and we all agree that there's the link between religion and economics and money is very important. We wouldn't agree, I guess, on how to interpret this connection, but we can go on discussing that afterwards. And thank you very much, everybody, and you will have the opportunity to see our speakers again and to see many other discussions during the symposium. So thanks and goodbye.